A shot and a score. Good angle for Ryan Stevens. And the sophomore ties it at two.
What a take, topside take. Stevens dodges into the middle, and this is what Harvard needs. They need some guys to step up. He dodges hard to the top side and just blasts a ball high and hard. Actually, it was more like off hip. That might be the toughest save for any goalie to make when it goes to the off hip. Off stick side, hip high, handcuffs a goalie every time.
Stevens getting by his man and finding some space there. He's having a good weekend, and Ithaca had 3 points on Friday and now scores his first goal today to tie this game at two. So we expected a good matchup between these two teams. We mentioned in the open, they played a 13-12 thriller in Cambridge. Cornell won that one during the regular season. A quirky stat, the last three times these teams have played, the final score has been 13-12. So close has been the story historically here. You see 09 at Harvard, last year at Cornell, and then this year at Harvard, all 13-12. And they are playing a tight one here early on again. Take a look at our stats so far. You see Harvard down in faceoffs 4-2, but ground balls, Cornell a little bit of an edge.
So when you're playing 5-on-5 lacrosse, okay, they're shutting off Cornell. Cornell's playing 5-on-5 lacrosse. If you can make them slide, scoring is far easier. Here's a slide. There's gonna be a lot better spacing on the next passes if they can move it quickly. If you can make them slide in 5-on-5, they're gonna be in trouble. 6-on-6, that extra guy makes a huge difference in bottling up the middle of the field.
Cornell's second midfield unit on the field right now. Scott Austin, number 20. J.J. Gilbane, number 25. Out there. This is Gilbane playing catch. Now fire and got crossbar. Gilbane drawing some pipe on that quick release. And right back comes Harvard. Through midfield, a shot and a low save by Fiore. Jeff Swingerland, number 24, trying to go coast to coast. The freshman D Mitty put a low shot on Fiore and he makes the save.
That's Fiore's specialty right there. If you shoot on the run, the mid-range, you know, it's a great save. He makes it look really easy when you try to throw that ball. Let's take a look at the low left here. He just gets down on low balls in that mid-range as well as anybody.
Back and forth action, and now Cornell's got Jack Dudley sending it to the right side. These goalies, both making some good saves early on. Fiore, in particular, has had a few sharp-looking saves as we see a save here on the other side by Krieger on the shot from Lang, and then the rebound into Krieger's stick.
That was a huge save. It looked like a kick save, and that was a big one because it was good dodging, good penetration against a long pole. He cut his man off beautifully and was able to get a shot.
Seven saves for Krieger on the game. He's looked tremendous, and we get a timeout called by the Crimson. So two goalies playing well, and the Ivy League championship, a tight one early on. 9 minutes to go here in the second quarter. It's 2-2 in Ithaca. Back after this. Back here in Ithaca, the Ivy League championship game. Some Harvard fans made the trip from Cambridge. It's 2-2 in the second quarter. And ESPNU's coverage of college softball continues this afternoon with an SEC showdown. Number 3, Tennessee, taking on number 6, Florida. College softball and ESPNU, that'll be today, following us at 3 Eastern time. And Jamie, this Harvard team looking good, and that is one very big reason why right now. Harry Krieger, the sophomore goalie from Timonium, Maryland, having himself a very strong first half.
That's huge. I mean, to get that kind of amount of saves in the first half, I mean, that's on pace to it's like a 50-point game in basketball. It's massive. It'll be interesting to see how the scoring goes here. I was looking at the stats from the game they played on April 9th earlier in the season, and there were 9 second-half goals scored by Harvard in that game, 8 by Cornell. So let's see if they settle in and really crank up the scoring in this thing.
Yeah, Cornell had the lead at halftime of that one, and they had a disastrous third quarter. Harvard outscored them 6-2 in that third quarter, but Cornell was able to pull it out in the fourth.
So Harvard is going to their invert offense, and what that means, for those of you who don't know, is middies are normally out top against good matchup short sticks. When you put them behind, they call it an invert in college lacrosse. When it's one man behind, it's called a single invert. It gives problems to the defense because you're so close to the net. If you get one little step, you can score a goal. You can practically dunk it. So watch Cornell looking to help here.
This is Peter Schwartz, the sophomore behind the net for the Crimson. Schwartz backing it up here. Makes his move, feeds it. Missed his man. That was Daniel Light, number 22. He was trying to find. Pass was way too high, but
Harvard
looks
is.
Looks like Harvard's going to keep possession here. It must have been deflected. The pass must have been tipped.
It was
Harvard's
a shot.
Keeping the ball.
I thought it was a shot. No,
oh, they call that a shot. Okay.
And they're going to have to keep it in again. As soon as they enter in, they're going to have to keep it in again. Just because the ball goes out of bounds doesn't mean that the stall warning is off. So here they go back to it again. Cornell's really packing it in. Harvard's making it easy. They were with 2 low crease men, really jamming up the scoring opportunities.
And there's a shot that goes wide from Ryan Stevens.
I like that dodge from Stevens much better because on the last set, it was kind of slow dodging and not much was happening here. Stevens went hard to the goal and it made a difference.
It'll be Gibbons bringing it back in off a screen. Feely on him, nice feed and a save by Fiore. He had Cohen on a pretty feed and I think that was Fiore who got a piece of that. It was Pipe actually, so the shot from Cohen drew some pipe, and now Cohen back in front of the net. Gibbons loses his footing. Feely got a stick on it, and it's picked up by Thomas Keith for Cornell. So a turnover as Feely knocks the ball away.
Unfortunate for Gibbons to lose his footing right there. It was a good possession for Harvard in the sense they got a couple decent shots. I wouldn't call them great shots, but it was time of possession is key. And to be able to just get into the rhythm of your offense.
There you see Pinnell on the left side of your screen being guarded by Paul Pate. Pate's had that assignment all day, trying to deny the ball. Here's Dudley, a shot and another save by Krieger. Jack Dudley from at least 12 yards there, and Krieger saw that one all the way.
Yeah, that shot was kind of telegraphed. You know, when goalies catch it that easily, it's because you told them where you were shooting it before you shot it. And it's the same reason why Fiore oftentimes makes great low saves, because so many players, you know, he's looking, he's, I don't say purely guessing, but every goalie is reading a shooter.
Cornell now over 15 minutes without a goal. So this Harvard defense starting to pile up some scoreless minutes here for Cornell. A feed in front and a missed shot by Matt Hall. Hall could not get a hold of that one. Now back the other way. Feely sends it. Oh, tried to put the ball on the ground and missed his man. A ground ball pass attempt there. Tom for sure could not pick it up. Turnover. ESPNU's coverage of college baseball will continue today, as Cal Poly will take on number 19 UC Irvine. That's college baseball on the U, 5:00 Eastern time. So this scoreless streak for Cornell starting to pile up a little bit now. Feely that time tried to be a little cute with the pass and that led to a turnover. Now the other way, it's a shot from a speedy Kevin Vaughn going down the right alley.
He is speedy. I know Cornell feels like he's one of the fastest players they've had to contend with all year, end to end, end line to end line. This kid has unbelievable wheels, and they need to. I'd like to see him get into the middle of the field and dodge, where he can go to his left or his right and be able to create some offense from the center, top center of the field.
This is Jack Doyle with the right hand cradle. reverses direction twice. Looking for space, fires it right on body. Fiore the save, and then he covers up the rebound. So that one was aimed right at the numbers from Doyle.
You love that when you're a goalie, to have an opportunity to have it thrown pretty much right into the center of your abdomen.
All right, let's see what Cornell can get going here on offense. Over 16 minutes now without a goal for this high-powered Cornell offense. Very uncharacteristic.
I think they should intentionally shoot and miss and then let Pinnell pick it up off the end line.
Pinnell heads behind the net with Pate covering him.
I'm half kidding, but if I'm Cornell, I really want Pinnell to have the ball. Picking and rolling like this or doing right here can help. Watch him pop away, and he can have an opportunity to get the ball thrown back to him.
Yeah, he was free on the pick and roll there, but they did not get the ball to him. Instead, they send it out top, and a shot just wide from Mike O'Neill. Now Pinnell will be able to pick it up off this backup. That, frankly, is the best way to get him the ball, is, you're right, miss a shot and have him bring it back in. Here's Pinnell. He's got plenty of space, goes left hand, and Krieger makes the save. Pinnell took his time there, went to the left, didn't get a lot on that shot, and Krieger able to make the save. Now a ground ball battle on the far side, picked up by Harvard.
Huge play, because that time Pinnell, he normally drives left-handed. He normally drives left-handed and has, oh, wait a minute, I'll talk about that in a second. We'll transition here.
As we come right back, it's Mock with space. Mock now draws a defender, and he'll back it up.
So what I was saying before, normally when he comes left-handed like that, he turns and executes a question mark shot, which is like a turnaround jump shot, where he turns around, switches hands, and throws it with less angle, but enough angle because he's pushed his way in. So let's take a look at this here. Now he puts it, he beat his guy so badly, he put it back into his left hand, and I think it took him by surprise, to be perfectly honest with you.
I totally agree. I think he had so much time to work with, he didn't know what to do, and he just sort of put a little bit of a weaker shot than he would have liked on goal there. Roy Lang firing one low and right. And we got a timeout on the field, so we got ourselves a little bit of a pitcher's duel here. These two goalies going at it, tete-a-tete. It is 2-2 in the Ivy League championship game. All right, the postseason about to get underway. The ESPN family of networks will have all the D1 men's lacrosse championship action as the road to Baltimore begins next weekend, May 14th and 15th, with 8 first-round games on ESPN2 and ESPNU. Then the quarterfinals the following weekend. And then the action will shift to Baltimore for the semis May 28th on ESPN2 and the championship game May 30th. So the month of May means championship lacrosse on ESPN and our networks. Meanwhile, we got a story developing here as there was a stick check during the break and a flag was thrown. So it looks like we're going to have an illegal stick penalty called against Harvard here. Let's see how this plays out. You see Chris Wojcik talking to the officials. What did you see, Jamie, as we were away? It looked for a second like it was actually, okay, you see there, number 8 for Harvard, Kevin Vaughn is without a stick, and it looks like he was the one who was nailed for the illegal stick infraction. That is a big call.
Well, I'm not sure.
That, in fact, was the call. Let's see what we get here. What?
Well, bottom line is that there's a couple of different ways you can be illegal. One is pocket depth. And the second is if your stick is altered in its size in any way, if the ball cannot be dislodged. And unfortunately, I was not looking. I did not see what the call was.
Well, it did go against Kevin Vaughn, number 8. So Vaughn called for the illegal stick. That is one of the biggest plays or biggest penalties you can draw in this sport. It's a 3-minute non-releasable penalty here against Harvard. So Cornell will be a man up for a total of 3 minutes. No matter how many times they score, they'll stay a man up. You see their first shot here going wide, backed up by Cornell.
It's every coach's and every player's nightmare. Because before the game, I'll tell you this, every coach makes every player, hey, go get your stick checked. Get your stick checked, make sure it's legal. And they all do, because you're all paranoid that something that might happen to you.
And there's a score. Man up goal for Cornell as they take advantage of this major, major mistake by Harvard.
So let's take a look at this.
That was number 29, Cody Bremner, Jamie.
So there, Cody Bremner is a Canadian from Victoria, BC. And watch the way they fake it across, throw back, and then beautiful shot, screenshot by Bremner. I remember this kid recruiting him when I was out at Denver, and he was a tremendous goal scorer. And I remember thinking that, you know, Cornell was lucky to get that kid.
Boy, you can't have a much bigger call than that. So Cornell remains a man up. And by the way, because this man up will not expire before the half, Cornell will get possession to start the third quarter a man up as well. So this could really be a defining moment in this game as the Big Red, remember, they had gone over 16 minutes without scoring before that call. And now they've scored once on the man up, and they've still got a minute 40 to play with an extra man.
Let me correct you in that the team that has the ball will start the next quarter.
Right,
if no one has the ball, yes, there will be a faceoff.
Right, if they've got possession on this man up, which I assume they will try to make sure they do, Jamie.
Deflected pass off Harvard. You know, if Harvard can get out of this, you know, without giving up, you know, more than two, I guess they're going to have to live with it and be happy.
And another score for Cornell. A big shot from right up the crease. Mitch McMichael going high. It's 4-2.
Let's take a look at this. He poked this ball into the top corner. Wow, watch him step right in, shoot around his man, low to high, and what an angle for that. Our cameraman did an unbelievable job with that angle.
All right, we will take a break here. It's suddenly Cornell on fire with this long man up. It's 4-2, Big Red. Welcome back to Ithaca, and a big day in college lacrosse. Tonight, ESPNU will reveal who's in and who is out in the 2001 NCAA Men's Lacrosse Tournament. The brackets revealed. Our experts will discuss every region, give their predictions for who will hoist the trophy. The NCAA Division I Men's Lacrosse Selection Show tonight, 9 o'clock Eastern Time on ESPNU. And Jamie, there's going to be a lot of fingernail biting tonight, and these are some of the teams that are going to be most nervous at 9 o'clock Eastern.
It is so exciting this time of year, and it is nerve-wracking. You've worked all year. Now let's take a look and see what we got. I mean, from an RPI perspective, Villanova looks like they have to be in. Hofstra's, you know, if you're going to go by RPI, which is a really big part of the component, yes, but Colgate has a better win than any of those teams on that list other than Penn. They just beat Maryland yesterday, and that is a massive win for Jim Nagel and his Colgate troops. Penn having the win over Duke, and Bucknell gives them a couple of great wins. I think Harvard, if they don't win today, they're going to be out, and I think it's going to be really interesting to see what sort of happens, because Villanova lost last night, too. They lost to Georgetown. I think had they won, they were almost automatic getting in. So I don't know. The criteria is there, but the emphasis seems to change year to year.
Well, meanwhile, back here in Ithaca, two straight man-up goals for Cornell, a three-minute illegal stick call that went against Harvard. Now Harvard in possession. They, of course, want to try to hold on to possession into halftime, but they can't. You knew Cornell was going to just chase that ball down. Now we'll see what the Big Red decide to do. 30 seconds left. They can certainly go up and try to get another shot. Man up before halftime.
Looked like they were looking for a timeout.
And they do take the timeout. So, Jamie, question here now with 25 seconds left. Assume they'll probably try to set up for one last shot on this man up, but they could also hold it and ensure they get possession to start the third quarter. There you see Kevin Vaughn, and you got a feel for Kevin Vaughn, the junior middy from Ridgewood, New Jersey, getting called for that illegal stick. The game was tied at 2, and two straight Cornell goals, man up.
I don't know if you noticed that Vaughn was throwing his throwing around, because his stick is out for the game now. And that's one of the worst things about it, is that, like, you know, your stick is, it's not like just picking up another baseball bat. I mean, these things, you work with it, and it's, and you know, you need to have a backup that's good. But I'll tell you right now, you take away someone's game stick, and it's a little bit of a heartbreaking moment.
All right, and as we just told you, tonight, 9 o'clock Eastern Time, the tournament selection show. Harvard looking to get in. They might have a hard time. They'll certainly be one of the bubble teams at 9 o'clock Eastern tonight if they don't win this automatic bid here. And then that's just the beginning of lacrosse in May on the ESPN family of networks. We've got all the Division I Men's Lacrosse Championship action. The road to Baltimore starting next weekend. 8 first-round games all across our air on ESPN2 and ESPNU. The quarterfinals May 21st and 22nd, also on ESPNU and ESPN2, and then the semifinals and finals Memorial Day weekend. So lots of great lacrosse action coming at you in the month of May here on the ESPN family of networks. 25 seconds left in this second quarter. Off the timeout, Cornell in possession, man up. And let's see what they decide to do here. Do they go for a shot or do they go for possession in the third quarter?
I would imagine they're gonna try for one look and then get possession.
Just be sure they back it up here. Second midfield unit out there, Langton. The man up unit, McMichael.
All right, they're going to hold it.
All right, so Cornell will take possession in the third quarter as they've got a 4-2 lead going into the half. And coming up on the Warrior Halftime Report, we'll have a Warrior Pro Session on the attack dodge, one of the big offensive moves in the sport of lacrosse for all you kids out there. Then our postseason calendar, and of course we'll come back with all the highlights and stats from a very interesting first half of lacrosse here in Ithaca. We'll be back right after this. It's halftime in Ithaca. Cornell a 4-2 lead in this Ivy League championship game. Back in a minute. Welcome to the Warrior Halftime Report. We're here in Ithaca, New York at halftime of the Ivy League championship game between Cornell and Harvard. And in today's Warrior Pro Session, Quint Kesenick and Matt Danowski break down the best way to pull off an attack dodge to score.
This halftime report is presented by Warrior. All hail. And now, a Warrior Pro Session with Quint Kesenick.
Attacking the goal from behind, the ability to beat your defenseman and generate a high percentage shot.
Running past your defender and getting to the goal is a science. It requires speed, power, precision, and a strategic plan. Consistently take the pole to the rack and you will be a superstar. Understanding your options is a prerequisite to becoming an unstoppable force.
We're joined by Matt Danowski, Tuareg Trophy-winning attackman and professional attackman. Matt, when you're pressing the goal from behind, what are some keys?
Well, what I like to do when I'm behind the cage, if I have a step in my defenseman, I like to dip my inside shoulder, kind of bury it into him, so I can get 2 extra steps, get myself in front of the cage, turn the corner, and I'll be able to shoot with the whole 6x6.
That's a move of speed and power and then protecting your stick, but typically defenders will do a better job than what I just did.
Absolutely here. Now, if I can't turn the corner and the stick's upfield, I want to take my defender to 5-5. All right, this is a very good spot in the field for an attackman because you can see the whole field and you're dangerous here. And when I get here, I'm going to read your body language to dictate what I do offensively.
Okay, so if you give me a reaction, I'll probably...
So if I'm right here, maybe I'll take one big step to the sidelines. Hopefully you bring your stick over, rocker step to the middle of the field, and get my shot off in front of the cage.
Rocker step creates the windshield wipe goal for you. What are some other things you can do?
Right, so if you're, again, you're playing good defense here, maybe I'll use your momentum against yourself. I'll push into you, so you push me back out, right to my step away shot, pivot off that inside foot, and get my hands free.
It's a fadeaway jump shot. Let's see that one more time. So you're initiating contact with me to create separation.
Lean into you, hopefully you push me out, right to the sidelines, right where I want to be. My stick and step to the sideline, I change hands out here, and I get my shot off.
What is one pro-level tip that a young attackman can benefit from?
Well, what a young attackman needs to learn is that you don't have to beat your man to score a goal. If someone's playing good defense on you, and you're around them, all you need to do is get your hands free. So maybe right here again, I can just step away, use you as a screen, and get my shot off that way.
So you create separation to free up your hands.
Exactly, just like a fadeaway jumper in hoops, all you really need to do is get some separation, get your hands free, you don't gotta beat him by 5 yards.
You're a young attackman dodging from behind the goal. Get to high percentage areas, and you will score a ton of goals like Matt.
Welcome back to Ithaca. We are at halftime. The number 2 team in the country, Cornell, a 4-2 lead in this Ivy League championship game over Harvard. A very tight defensive first half that really just opened up in the last couple of minutes after a man-up opportunity that continues for Cornell into the second half. I'm Rob Similcare along with Jamie Monroe. And Jamie, we talked a lot going in about Rob Pinnell and this great Cornell offense. Pinnell scored the first goal for Cornell, but then he was shut down by Harvard.
Well, Harvard is locking him off, and they're playing a five-on-five game for most of the time. And, you know, it's very frustrating for a player when you're getting locked off. You're used to handling the ball probably 65% of the time, and now he's not handling it very much. He was actually fortunate to score an early goal to kind of get it going so he didn't get overly frustrated.
Well, let's take a look at the first half highlights, and we see that Pinnell did get off to a good start for Cornell. This big red team opened the scoring with Pinnell finding a little space and scoring to make it 1-0.
Now you're going to watch here in the 5-on-5 scenario where they have the opportunity to find an open man inside while they're locking Pinnell.
And then it was the goalies who took over for quite a stretch. A.J. Fiore on one side really was sharp, a couple of good chances, but then Harvard able to tie the game at 2. Then this was a turning point, an illegal stick call against Harvard. Number 8 for Harvard, Kevin Vaughn, called for the illegal stick. It was 2-2 at that point, and that led to this.
In a championship game, to have an illegal stick is just a coach's worst nightmare, a player's worst nightmare, and Cornell cashed in with 2 beautiful left-handed shots to take a 4-2 lead.
And they will still be a man up as we start the third quarter in possession of the ball. You see our first half stats, shots, Cornell up 23-17. Great first half for Harry Krieger, Harvard's goalie. 9 saves, 5 for A.J. Fiore. Faceoffs about even, and the ground ball is Cornell with the edge. Cornell with 2 man-up goals, and they're going to have a little more time man-up as well. And this, of course, a game for automatic qualification into the NCAA tournament. The winner of this will go to the tournament as the automatic bid from the Ivy League. And here you see the other AQs around the NCAA.
Last night, Hartford with a huge upset over Stony Brook to make their first appearance in the NCAA tournament. Delaware with an upset victory to win their championship. Denver was the favorite and took care of business all year long. Obviously, here today, we're still in a barn burner. Detroit and Siena, great opportunity for 2 new teams, or for Detroit to be another new team in. And Bucknell finally gets over the hump with a great season. Frank Federaca has done an unbelievable job playing tremendous offense and tremendous defense.
By the way, Siena's up 7-0 in that Metro Atlantic Conference Final, so it looks like it will be Siena getting the automatic bid from the MAC. And as we get ready for the start of this second half, the selection show, Jamie, is tonight. We're going to have a lot of people worrying. And these guys won't be worrying. These are the top 8 seeds, according to you. Assuming Cornell wins? You're figuring they'll be a 2 seed?
This is assuming Cornell wins, and these teams probably aren't worrying as much as they're wondering. I think Denver and North Carolina are wondering, are we going to have home games, or are we going to be on the road? Some feel that Denver's going to have a good enough record to be there. Some feel that they're going to have to be on the road at Carolina.
Well, quickly off the restart, Cornell scores. A man-up goal. Remember, they had possession because of the man-up. And they make it 5-2. So that is now the 3rd goal as a result of that illegal stick call.
This is so interesting because they've been locking off Rob Pinnell on man-up. And if you notice, he picks the ball up out of bounds and dodges one-on-one against the short stick. And all of a sudden now they slide right in. A stick breaks on the play and Mock slides in, which he does so well. Pinnell, perfect feed, hands back. He's incredible about protecting his stick, keeping his hands back, and making the pass at exactly the right moment.
So that continues the damage from that illegal stick call. Remember, no faceoff to start the second half because Cornell had possession, man up. Those are the rules. And that will finally do it for this 3-minute